One essential mineral that our body needs to get through the diet is copper. And typically we take in about 1 to 2 milligrams per day from the food we eat. Things like whole grains, beans, nuts, and potatoes. But really our body only needs about 0.75 milligrams per day. So that extra copper is excreted. About 90% of the excess copper is excreted into the bile, where it eventually ends up as fecal copper. And the other 10% is excreted in the urine. In Wilson's disease, there's this genetic defect that results in the excess copper being kept in the body and deposited in various tissues, where it's definitely not supposed to be. And just like iron, free copper can react with hydrogen peroxide in the body to form the hydroxyl radical, a reactive oxygen species that's pretty good at damaging tissue. So over time, those tissues are seriously damaged by free radical generation. Now, your liver cells, or your hepatocytes, play a really important role in helping the body get rid of excess copper. So usually the copper from the diet is absorbed into the stomach and small intestine via enterocytes and passed off into the portal vein to the liver. Once it's in the liver, it's sent to a special transport protein called ATP7B, which has a couple super important jobs. The first job is that it binds copper to apoceruloplasmin, which is the major copper-carrying protein in the blood, and is responsible for carrying about 95% of the copper in the blood. After it binds copper, it's then just called ceruloplasmin, and this guy can haul 6 molecules of copper at once. ATP7B's other job is to gather up the rest of the copper into vesicles to be exocytosed into the bile canaliculi, where it goes into the bile and is eventually excreted. With Wilson's disease, there's this autosomal recessive defect in the ATP7B transport protein. As you could probably guess, that means that it can't incorporate the copper into ceruloplasmin or excrete it into the bile. Since it's not doing either of these things anymore, the copper builds up inside the hepatocyte and starts to produce free radicals. Eventually, all this built-up copper and free radical damage injures or destroys the hepatocyte, causing free copper to spill out into the interstitial space, and from there it can access the blood supply. Once it's in the blood supply, it's circulated to and deposited in other tissues, where it also causes free radical damage over time. One organ in particular is the brain, and for this reason, Wilson's disease can have serious neurological symptoms and complications. Depending on where it deposits, it can cause different disorders. If it deposits in the basal ganglia, it can cause a movement disorder that's a lot like Parkinsonism. If it gets to the cerebral cortex, it can be toxic to neurons, which can lead to neuronal cell death and dementia. One place that it can also deposit that can be sort of helpful for diagnosis is in the decimates membrane of the cornea, which is this membrane between the stroma and the endothelial layer of the cornea. So you'll look for something called Kaiser-Fleischer rings, which are visible copper deposits in this membrane of the cornea. Since it starts in the liver, though, liver damage is usually seen first, right? And it often progresses from acute hepatitis to cirrhosis and liver failure, and symptoms usually present in late childhood. Typically, when you look at someone's blood with Wilson's disease, you'll note a couple pretty key things. One is that there'll be an overall decreased level of ceruloplasmin in the blood. Because remember that you need apoceruloplasmin to bind to copper for it to be called ceruloplasmin. So without ATP7B binding copper to apoceruloplasmin, all you have is this apoceruloplasmin, which is relatively unstable and doesn't last very long in the plasma. And this can be important for diagnosing Wilson's disease early on. Another key feature to note, though, as hepatocytes are damaged and release free or unbound copper, there'll be increased levels of free copper in the blood, right? Which will also lead to increased free copper in the urine. Other common complications from deposited copper in other tissues include an enlarged liver and spleen, hepatosplenomegaly, renal disease due to damage to the proximal tubules of the kidney, and hemolytic anemia due to the direct damage that circulating free copper causes to red blood cells. As far as treatments go, penicillamine will usually be used for Wilson's disease. Penicillamine is this alpha amino acid metabolite of penicillin, but it doesn't share the same antibiotic properties as penicillin. Instead, though, it's a copper chelating agent, meaning it binds to free copper in the serum and makes it easier to excrete. Also, though, patients can be given zinc or ammonium tetrathiomolybdate, both which reduce copper reabsorption in the urine and therefore increase the amount of copper that's ultimately excreted in the urine. Finally, if the liver has been damaged to the point of cirrhosis and liver failure, a liver transplant might be needed.